In 1973, in a small US country estate, President Richard Nixon was waiting for the arrival of a special guest, the General Secretary of the USSR, Leonid Brezhnev. A chic car stopped near the entrance. The car door opened, and from it appeared a delicate woman's leg. A pretty blonde got out of the car. Behind her appeared the figure of the Soviet leader. Nixon hurried towards them. He stretched out his hand and froze. Rather than responding with a broad smile, Brezhnev gave the president his mistress's hand. This had never happened before. Only Leonid Brezhnev would have dared to do that. He was a connoisseur of female beauty. He had over 50 lovers, nurses, singers, flight attendants, women of different profession and social status. Their only similarity was their appearance. All Brezhnev's mistresses were short, fair-haired, and light-eyed. They looked quite ordinary. But it was his obsession with this look that would become his curse. Leonid Brezhnev could barely move, spoke with difficulty, breathed heavily, and complained of memory lapses. In people's memory, he remained a laughingstock. But few knew that Brezhnev had not always been like this. He was the youngest member of the Politburo. He was in good health, loved hunting and motor racing. He used to be happy and cheerful. But a personal tragedy had undermined his physical health. His unrequited love for a woman had driven him crazy. He became a drug addict and ruined his life. Novorossiysk, 1943. He was rushing through the thick smoke like a madman. The Germans suddenly attacked. The field was illuminated with bright flashes. Dead soldiers and blood everywhere. His ears rang to the sound of cannon fire. No one was left to operate the machine gun, so Leonid grabbed it. He started to frantically shoot at the enemy. There were not enough rounds. He knew this was the end. Help would not come. He suddenly heard a terrible whistling noise. The last thing he remembered was an unbearable pain piercing through his body. His hands were stained with blood. Leonid blacked out. Several days later, he came round. When he looked at himself in the mirror, he shuddered. His face was in bandages. He tried to talk, but the searing pain pierced his jaw. Later, Brezhnev was informed that during the battle, a grenade had exploded near him. A splinter hit him in the jaw. He underwent a serious operation. But doctors could give no guarantees of a full recovery. He had never felt so weak and helpless. The handsome Brezhnev could no longer recognize himself. When he looked in the mirror, he saw a monster. He furiously tried to rip off the bandages, but a hand stopped him. Leonid looked up. A blonde girl with kind eyes was looking at him. Brezhnev froze. What a beauty! The thought that she might pity him was unbearable. In desperation, he turned away. A month later, his bandages would be removed, and Leonid would not recognize himself. His mouth was distorted, and he had a swollen face. The former political instructor of the 18th Army had lost his good looks. The man in the mirror could not utter a word. His jawbone hadn't healed properly, so Leonid Brezhnev lost his power of speech. Despite the pain, he tried to read, but he could only make a wheezing noise. But for several weeks, Brezhnev exercised his jaw in an attempt to speak. But it was all in vain. He wanted to scream out in pain and frustration. Would he, a political instructor, remain handicapped forever? He wouldn't be able to communicate with his people. His career would surely be over. In desperation, Leonid threw a book at the wall. He was sobbing into his pillow when suddenly he heard a calm, soothing voice. Tamara was reading his book aloud carefully, articulating each word. No, she was not mocking him. Her voice trembled. She didn't want to offend this broken, devastated man. Leonid was ashamed. She remained at his side, comforting and caring for him. When Brezhnev had a fever, she wouldn't sleep. Leonid was enlightened. He was afraid to move. He listened to her, hoping that this moment would go on forever. For the next days, Tamara returned to his bedside. Thanks to her, Brezhnev learned to speak again and restore his diction. He could no longer imagine himself without this woman. She gave him back his hope and confidence. A long-forgotten feeling had been reawakened. Brezhnev had fallen madly in love. Tamara felt sure that they would get married. She didn't care if Brezhnev was 40 and she was only 20. Most importantly, they loved each other. But fate would decide otherwise. Tamara, a field hospital doctor, would be remembered not as the wife of the future general secretary, but as his most painful mystery. High-ranking servicemen often had what was known as regimental wives. Tamara was just such a wife to Leonid Brezhnev. She'd been living with him for a very long time. However, she remained a mysterious legend. Leonid sneaked into the room. Tamara sat motionlessly on a chair. He silently approached and gently covered her eyes. However, Tamara did not move. Leonid understood that something had happened. He noticed a newspaper lying nearby. On the front page, there was a picture of Leonid Brezhnev in full colonel's uniform. And beneath it was an article about his heroic feat during which he had been severely wounded. The colonel and political instructor, Comrade Brezhnev, helped repel the German attack. After suffering heavy losses, the Germans retreated. The article mentioned Brezhnev's previous achievements, his military exploits, and his personal qualities. But in the newspaper, there was also a seemingly unimportant sentence: an exemplary party member and a great family man. But these words played a crucial role in the fate of the future General Secretary. Leonid lowered his eyes. He couldn't hide any longer. He hadn't told her that he already had a wife and two children. He didn't tell her because he was afraid that if Tamara knew about it, she would leave him, and he couldn't imagine his life without her. In desperation, Brezhnev threw himself at the feet of his lover, begging her for forgiveness and understanding. But Tamara didn't seem to hear. A fearful Leonid promised to leave his wife and children. When the war was over, they would be together as they had dreamed. But soon, Brezhnev would be discharged from the hospital and returned to the front. From there, he would write letters both to his family, waiting in Moscow, and to his beloved woman, who would secretly pray to God that her loved one would be safe. This went on for 2 years, when the good news arrived. The Soviet troops had captured Berlin. The war was over, and he could finally go home. 1945, Moscow. He slowly walked up the stairs. He could already see the door of his apartment. Leonid knew that his children and Victoria were waiting for him. They had been married for 20 years. The love between them had long gone. But it was replaced with sincere friendship, along with two of the most beautiful children in the world. Leonid hadn't seen his family for 4 years during the war. And now he came to announce that he was leaving for another woman. She was already waiting in anticipation in the small flat in Moscow. The future of his children, wife and lover, depended on him. He pressed the doorbell. The door opened immediately. The apartment became full of cheerful hubbub. They hugged and kissed him. The children have changed so much. They have grown up. Leonid's heart sank. He was very fond of them, but he could not lie anymore. That same evening, Leonid and Victoria had a difficult conversation. He told his wife everything, about meeting Tamara, about their feelings for each other, which he had been hiding for 2 years. He was explaining everything and asking for forgiveness. But Brezhnev did not realize that his 16-year-old daughter, Galina, had been listening to him. Her father's words were very painful to listen to. How could he do this to them? Galina wanted to believe that her father loved her and her mother, but she couldn't. Leonid was afraid to look into his wife's eyes. His heart was breaking. He felt terrible guilt. Vika didn't cry or cause a scandal. If she had done, it would have been easier for Leonid. But his wife remained silent. It made it harder. Gradually, she came to her senses. She refused to stay and said she would file for divorce. He could go to the other woman, provided that Leonid remained in the house until morning, so he could explain everything to the children. Brezhnev had no choice. He agreed, not realizing the terrible consequences of his decision. His wife was a difficult woman. In appearance, she was very similar to Mao Zedong. If you compare these two portraits, I think you'll find a lot in common. He suffered constantly. Only the state security authorities were protecting him. They were trying to isolate Leonid Brezhnev from these troubles. That night, he didn't sleep. He was turning and moaning. He blamed himself for being such a coward. The guilt haunted him. His eyes were watering, but he couldn't sleep. He tried to convince himself that he needed to explain everything to his children. He simply had no choice. He couldn't lie to Tamara a second time. He walked around the apartment. The children were sleeping. Leonid entered his wife's room. The bed was made. Vika hadn't gone to bed. His wife was not there. Confused, Leonid went to see the one who would understand, the one who would calm and comfort him. He forcefully pulled the door handle. The apartment was unlocked. He rushed inside. Why was it so quiet, and where was Tamara? In the middle of the room sat a hunched female figure. She turned. Leonid froze. Vika looked at him calmly. She had found the apartment address on a receipt that was lying in Brezhnev's jacket pocket. While Leonid was at home, she went to visit the woman who was about to destroy her family. Looking into his wife's eyes, everything began to make sense. Tamara was gone for good. No, this cannot happen. What has Vika told her? A crazy thought ran through his head. Run after her. Make her come back, no matter what. I must say, that was one of his most important qualities that manifested itself both in his personal life and in his politics. He was a stubborn man. His obstinacy was legendary. He could break through anything. Gas pedal to the floor, 120 kilometers per hour on the speedometer. He was driving like a madman. Sweat filled his eyes. He can see the station, but there is not much time. He must get Tamara back. For the first time in his life, he was running at full speed, elbowing his way through the crowds. He ran past irritated passers-by and noisy market sellers. He looked, but couldn't see her. He feared he may never see her again. In the distance, he saw a familiar figure. He felt the tears well as he rushed towards her. He grabbed her and held her close. He found her at last. He kissed her urgently on her cheeks, lips, shoulders. Fearful he might lose her again, he didn't care that the whole station was watching them. He had found her and would not lose her again. Tamara gently released herself from his embrace. He looked at her with horror. He would never let her go again. But Tamara quietly broke their embrace. Leonid was petrified. He looked at her helplessly. Leonid would never forget the sight of that petite female figure slowly disappearing into the crowd. He could not remember how he managed to drive back. He didn't know where he was or what he was doing. Suddenly, it was all about Tamara. He saw her every delicate profile, every blonde silhouette, every time he wanted to move forward, to cry out with joy. But it was all in vain. She was no longer in the crowd. He would not go after his Tamara again. But he would never be able to forget her either. In Leonid Brezhnev's broken heart, there arose an unusual hatred. He blamed his wife for taking away his precious Tamara. He would seldom appear at home and put all his energy into his work. He built a successful career and became a trusted associate of General Secretary Nikita Khrushchev. And when the time came, he would take his place and start a new era in Soviet history. Of course, in many respects, Brezhnev was politically naive compared with his predecessors Lenin, Stalin, and even Khrushchev. The era of Brezhnev is a peaceful, stagnant backwater. Perhaps people needed to sit and think. To contemplate the snow falling outside the window, not the ranks of prisoners, the tanks or the marching troops. It's not interesting to watch these things. In a sense, the Brezhnev era had been blessed. The position of General Secretary would bring him unlimited power and many privileges, such as a collection of unique weapons and 300 of the best vintage cars in the world. He had a huge fleet of vehicles, including Lincolns, Cadillacs, Rolls-Royces, Zills, and Mercedes. He loved them all, used to drive them himself. The guards were behind him, naturally. Sometimes we had a flat tire. We would hurriedly change the wheel and try to catch up with him. But rarely could, because he drove so fast. As well as cars, he also collected gorgeous women. They all looked the same, slender, blonde, blue-eyed. Brezhnev would drown his pain in their embraces, seeing Tamara in each one of them. Translators, flight attendants, typists, and singers came and went. Brezhnev had no time to remember their names. He shocked the world with his amazing escapades. But nobody realized that the man with the sincere smile, who boasted about his amorous conquests, was in fact miserable. From the outside, everything seemed fine. A successful person, a prominent politician, a lady killer. There were many women on his list. A residence keeper in Zavidovo Anna, a maid from Zaretche, Dacha Maria, a secretary Alla, the daughter of communist leader of Bulgaria, Lyudmila Zhivkova. The KGB regularly supplied the leader with pretty blonde lovers. Brezhnev didn't object. To him, it was like a game. For example, in Sochi, he met a singer, Anna Shalfeva, who worked in the local Philharmonic Society. With the help of his orderly, or batman, he locked her up in a room. She was outraged by his boorish behavior. She managed to escape through an open window. Leonid Brezhnev tried to make up with her by giving her flowers and courting her. Gradually, he broke down her resistance. Brezhnev had another secret life carefully concealed by the General Secretary.
Це почалося з від'їзду Тамари. Він погано.
It began after Tamara left. He didn't sleep well.
Остаточно виснажував себе фізично на кілька годин.
He tossed and turned all night. Then in the morning fell into a deep sleep for a few hours.
З часом усе мене. Але генсек помилявся.
Брежнєв hoped his insomnia would pass, but it got worse with age. His problems were being destroyed before his eyes. He couldn't forgive his wife for the grief he had suffered. Brezhnev and his wife were gradually drifting apart, but Victoria seemed resigned. She didn't blame him for his love affairs and silently put up with them. Her silence drove him mad. Brezhnev did not know what to think. Very soon, he would pay dearly for his wife's sufferings. The suburbs of Moscow, 1972. He heard a terrible din in the sitting room and ran out into the corridor. His daughter Galina could barely stand. Brezhnev couldn't hold back his anger. His assistants brought him a picture of Galina dancing the can-can on a table with naked legs and skirt pulled up. This was not the first time she had behaved this way. Galia was drinking. His son Yura was drinking. You understand? But it was all concealed. Victoria Petrovna had been suffering from this affliction. She knew all the details. Leonid Brezhnev did not know everything. He had two concerns. Firstly, his daughter's affairs, including Maris Lipa and Kio, an illusionist. His son was an alcoholic who would go to Red Square and proclaim that Brezhnev was a fool. He was arrested, but when they realized who he was released. It was not easy for Brezhnev to deal with. It was painful for Brezhnev to watch Galina. Another failed marriage, hard drinking. He wanted her to stay and talk, but drunken Galina laughed in his face. Brezhnev lost his temper and slapped her. She soon came to her senses. She gave her father a long, withering look and then left without saying a word. Brezhnev did not know that Galina's scandalous behavior was revenge for hurting her mother. Fights with his wife continued until Brezhnev broke up with Tamara. He couldn't forgive his wife for the grief he'd suffered. Brezhnev was gradually drifting apart from his family. But even then, Victoria seemed resigned. He didn't remember her blaming him for his amorous adventures. Galina hadn't forgotten about crying in her room all those years ago when she heard about her father's unfaithfulness. How she blamed herself for her parents' fighting. And watching her father continuing to taunt her mother. Galina had become angry and now sought vengeance. For the first time in his life, Brezhnev slapped his child. She had grown up under these circumstances, but much of it was his fault. Brezhnev adored his Galina, indulged all of her whims, but his daughter became fretful and spoiled. Previously, he'd put up with her tricks. But now, because of the insomnia, despair tore at Brezhnev's heart. He had to do something. And Brezhnev had found a solution. He remembered the innocent pills to relieve stress recommended to him by his comrades from the Politburo. The general secretary hated pills and never called for doctors. but he simply saw no other solution. Insomnia was ruining his life and driving him mad. Taking life-saving pills was the only solution. That night, he slept like a baby. There were no horrible visions. Panic and fear had vanished. In the morning, for the first time in several years, he woke up refreshed and rested, all thanks to the innocent pills. From then on, he would take them on a daily basis. The state of the General Secretary improved. Fatigue and nervousness disappeared. He felt full of strength and inspiration. Brezhnev couldn't imagine that soon he would become addicted to the pills. To intensify the sleeping pills' effect, he would take them with vodka. This heady mixture would be the beginning of the end. As well as soothing, the medicine Noxiron, like diphenhydramine, also has a psychotropic effect. When taken in large doses, it turns into a drug, and when mixed with alcohol, it can be a killer. He became addicted to sleeping pills. In the beginning, he took one pill, but within a few months, he was taking two or three. Someone said, Leonid Ilyich, I take a pill with alcohol. He asked, does it help? And one of the Politburo members answered, yes, it helps. And then, little by little, it got to the point that we were forced to dissolve vodka in water so that he wouldn't go too far. Moscow, 1972. The USSR was celebrating the 55th anniversary of the October Revolution. The atmosphere in the Column Hall of the House of the Unions was solemn. Recently, workers, peasants, soldiers, and party members were being awarded. Faces were radiant with smiles. Everyone was euphoric. A smiling Brezhnev was meeting the guests of honor. Next to the General Secretary sat his secretary, who was also his new passion. Faces were flashing. Brezhnev felt dizzy and terribly sleepy. Occupied by his own thoughts, he didn't notice himself shaking the hand of the next guest, a general. He was thanking Brezhnev for a medal, but Leonid didn't care. Then from behind the military man came a blonde woman. Not young, but beautiful, with a painfully familiar face. Brezhnev froze. He couldn't breathe. His heart was pounding. Surely it could not be her. Tamara left Moscow many years before. He thought he would never see her again. But there she is, so close. So close, and yet so distant. He didn't know what to say. Tamara looked at him with calm, confident eyes. She was no longer a naive little girl whose eyes shone with love and affection. Life had changed her. There in the north was born another Tamara, one who had forgotten how to feel. Her memories had been erased. Brezhnev didn't know that she had married a general and was living a quiet life. He was looking at her with a long, piercing gaze. Tamara gently took her hand away. The General Secretary felt unwell. He walked through the crowd, wanting only one thing, to escape. Brezhnev was driving his car through narrow country roads. He didn't care where. His hands were trembling. He wanted to get rid of this strange obsession. Brezhnev felt the car judder as it raced towards the ditch. At the last minute, he managed to drive off to the side. He breathed heavily, not understanding why he'd stopped, and then he began to cry like a baby. Weak and powerless, he had failed to take his own miserable life. The General Secretary instinctively felt for the pills in his pocket, but they were not there. His head was spinning, his hands were shaking, he felt a terrible throbbing pain. His head felt as though it would explode. When he came to his senses, Victoria was sobbing next to him. She told him that he had just suffered a severe stroke. She begged him not to kill himself, but Brezhnev didn't care about anything. It was a very strange moment in the life of Leonid Brezhnev. He was banned from smoking and drinking. He could no longer drive his car. He had slowed down. He asked, "Am I a czar or am I not a czar?" He had great power, but was cut off from everything. He decided to fight for his own freedom. The only thing that he still had, his freedom to take pills with vodka, knowing that such a combination was poisoning his body. One thing intensifies the other. He demanded sleeping pills with vodka for dinner and became addicted. He realized that the drug was much more effective taken this way. In just a few months, he had become very ill. In 1976, he survived a clinical death, then a heart attack. A year later, while on holiday, he would fall asleep while swimming. His guards only just managed to bring the General Secretary round. Now, the great and mighty USSR was governed by a weak, feeble old man who could barely move or talk, sometimes forgetting where he was and not seeing the line between reality and delusions. He was no longer interested in public affairs. Brezhnev shifted his routine and responsibilities. Here is what the foreign policy propaganda of the USSR, Valentin Falin, wrote. "Our department was subordinated directly to Brezhnev, but endorsing the papers, the General Secretary didn't decide anything. The more papers he was slipped, the less he realized what was behind these papers." Thus, in 1979, peace-loving Brezhnev, who opposed army conflicts, signed an order to bring troops into Afghanistan. And when he realized what he'd done, he decided to resign. He stopped understanding anything. I remember this phrase stuck in my ears. I was watching one of the congresses, the 24th Party Congress, or maybe one of his speeches. He'd finished reading, looked at all those present in the hall like this, said in his Brezhnev style, rattled off. And left. With a heavy heart, his wife watched what her Leonid was turning into. She was extremely happy when he decided to retire. But these dreams wouldn't come true. Brezhnev couldn't resign. They had persuaded the sickly and feeble General Secretary that the country needed him. And Brezhnev believed them. Behind his back, a clique of party functionaries wanted this to last as long as possible, so there wouldn't be anyone to restore order. Then, of course, it turned into a farce. Everyone laughed. Now, the entire world was laughing at Brezhnev. The West, which had once so candidly met the Soviet leader, was openly mocking him. While visiting abroad, Brezhnev, as always, stood in the car and welcomed friendly people. But no one knew that a bodyguard was helping him to stand. Leonid Brezhnev couldn't keep his balance. He was taking more and more sleeping pills. He was literally begging doctors and security guards for pills. As a result, they began to hide drugs from him. Everyone was ordering his pills. I know that through Andropov, they ordered fake pills in Switzerland. He could easily call you in the middle of the night and say, "It's not working, I will take these." He had his own supply. Sometimes he would ask people from the Politburo. We often had to ask people he was close to, "Comrades, please do not give your medicines to Leonid Ilyich. You will kill him." Brezhnev jumped out of his bed. Outside the window, he saw a strange shadow. Something was quietly knocking on the glass. He covered his ears and tried to sleep. But without the usual pills, he could not fall asleep. Of course, his wife had some pills, but she'd hidden them. He decided to go and find them. Brezhnev crept into Victoria's bedroom and looked through her drawers, but the drugs weren't there. They were in a special locked place. Brezhnev could not resist. He woke up Vika and begged her to give him the pills. But his wife was adamant. So he picked the lock and with joyful eyes went back to his own bedroom. He poured several pills onto his palm. After a moment, he felt relief. His head began to swim, and then suddenly he seemed to awake from a nightmare. Brezhnev saw himself sitting on the floor as an old hunched man. His body was trembling. No, this can't be him. What has happened during these few years? What has he become? It was disgusting and embarrassing, sick, lonely and useless. Like a madman, he was swaying and whispering something to himself. Suddenly, someone's tender arms embraced him. He raised his head. Victoria was looking at him with love and affection. Brezhnev could not resist. He hid his face in her shoulder and folded her in his arms, as if afraid that she would disappear. For the first time in many years, he was grateful to her for her support and affection. Victoria gently lifted him up. She put him to bed as if he was a child. She stroked his head. Brezhnev's eyes opened. She was always there for him. She tolerated his unfaithfulness, resentments. She looked after him when he was ill. He had many women. All his life he had been chasing a ghost. And yet all this time, near here, was a woman who truly loved and needed him. He wanted to fall on his knees and ask for forgiveness, but he felt sleepy. For the first time in his life, Brezhnev did not want to fall asleep. But the effect of the pills was irreversible. A happy smile lit up his face. Brezhnev knew exactly what to do. He would give up taking the pills. He would get back his life and finally tell Victoria the truth. He will tell her that he was wrong, that he loves her, and she will surely forgive him. He fell asleep with a happy smile on his face. Nothing to fear or worry about now. Only warmth, peace at last. His body was found in the morning. Doctors stated that Brezhnev had died painlessly and quietly. His heart stopped while he was asleep.